In a decade of war, more than 1,300 Americans have lost limbs on the battlefield. And that fact led the Department of Defense to start a crash program to help veterans and civilians by creating an artificial arm and hand that are amazingly human. But that's not the breakthrough. We don't use that word very often because it's overused. But when you see how they have connected this robotic limb to a human brain, you will understand why we made the exception. To take this ultimate step, they had to find a person willing to have brain surgery to explore new frontiers of what it is to be human. That person would have to be an explorer with desperate need, remarkable courage, and maybe most of all, a mind that is game.
The story will continue in a moment.
The person they chose is Jan Sherman, a Pittsburgh mother of two and writer with a mind nimble enough to match wits on The Wheel of Fortune in 1995.
I'm going to solve the puzzle.
Go ahead.
Two cues for words.
Yes.
When her mind triumphed, her brain sent signals of delight to every muscle in her body. But a year after this moment, those brain signals were being cut off.
One day I had trouble. In the evening, I was making a lot of trips in and out of the car. It felt like my legs were dragging behind me.
Within 2 years, a genetic disease called spinocerebellar degeneration broke the connection between brain and body. Now at age 53, Jan Sherman can move only the muscles in her face and a few in her neck. She's dependent on a caregiver for nearly all of her daily needs.
52 across.
And her mother to help her solve the puzzles she loves.
Healed? Oh, you're good.
At the same time Jan Sherman was putting her mind to a new life, a neuroscientist just across town at the University of Pittsburgh was imagining how people like Jan might be restored. Andy Schwartz, on the right, is working on an ambitious Defense Department project called Revolutionizing Prosthetics. 4 years ago, we visited his lab, and Schwartz showed us how he implanted tiny sensors like this one into the brains of monkeys and then wired them to a crude robotic arm. Schwartz told us that when the monkey thinks about moving his own arm, his brain cells or neurons fire off electrical signals. The sensor in his brain can pick up these signals and send them to the robot.
So he's operating the arm in three dimensions, up, down, forward, and back.
As well as the gripper.
Well, what you're telling me is that the monkey is operating this arm with nothing but his thoughts.
Absolutely.
What are the chances that a human being would be able to do the same thing?
Oh, we think a human being could do much better.
That conversation was in 2008, and since then, the $150 million Revolutionizing Prosthetics program has reached farther than most thought possible.
Awesome.
Dr. Jeffrey Ling, a retired Army colonel and neurologist, is in charge. After seeing the wounded on several tours in Iraq and Afghanistan, he told his team that he wanted a breakthrough within 5 years.
Did any of them say, look, Colonel, we're not sure we can do this?
Oh, absolutely. They thought that we were crazy. But that's quite all right, because I think it's in our insanity that things happen.
That madness led to genius in labs all across the country. At the Applied Physics Laboratory at Johns Hopkins University in Maryland, Michael McLaughlin led the multi-million dollar engineering of what has become the most sophisticated hand and arm ever developed. It's the same size and weight of an average man's arm and hand. And everything is inside, including the computers and the batteries.
Is there anything that your natural arm and hand can do that the mechanical hand can't?
Well, I can do this.
Okay, there's that.
But other than that, virtually everything your natural hand can do, that this prosthetic is able to do. Same strength, too.
Same strength?
Same strength. So we can curl 45 to 50 pounds with the arm.
They've thought of a lot of ways to use it. When set on wheels, it can bring a human touch where no human can go. In this demonstration, we wore a visor that showed us the video feed from the robot. These gloves move the robotic hands, and we practice pulling a wire out of a bomb.
Come on, give me that pinch.
There you go. Awesome. Oh,
but the holy grail in the project was finding a way to connect the robot directly to the brain.
Who wouldn't want to do this? When they told me I heard about the study, I said, oh, absolutely. I couldn't not do this.
Last February, Jan Sherman put herself on the line for a more sophisticated version of the surgery that they had done earlier in the monkeys.
There's a brain surgery involved. It's experimental. Why were you so excited about it?
I've always believed there's a purpose to my illness. I didn't think I would ever find out what it was in my lifetime. And here came the study where they needed me. You know, they couldn't just pick any Tom, Dick, or Harry off the street. And in a few years, the quadriplegics and the amputees, it's just going to help. The Department of Defense is funding some of it for the vets. To be of use to them and service to them, what an honor.
What I'm going to do right now is I'm just making some marks here in your hair.
The procedure was done by University of Pittsburgh neurosurgeon Elizabeth Tyler Kabara, who showed us that the area that controls hand and arm movement is accessible right on the surface of the brain.
What are the dangers?
We worry about if we were to accidentally tear a blood vessel while we were putting them in, that we could cause a blood clot that would collect on the surface of the brain. Probably the thing we worry about the most is the possibility of infection.
I mean, you do have a connection through the skull to the outside world.
Absolutely.
May I have some irrigation?
During the 6-hour surgery, two sensor arrays, each the size of a pea, were placed on the surface of Jan's brain.
Woohoo!
Then they were wired to two computer connections called pedestals, the gateways to Jan's thoughts.
You know, people are going to look at those pedestals in your skull and they're going to think, that has to hurt. Is it painful? Has it been difficult in any way?
For a few hours after I woke up, I had the worst case of buyer's remorse. I was thinking, oh my God, I had brain surgery. Why didn't anyone stop me? Why didn't they say, Jan, you're crazy? But as soon as the headache went away, that kind of talk went away too.
5 months after the surgery, we came back to see whether she would be able to control the robotic arm with nothing but her thoughts. They plugged her brain into the computer, and this is what we saw.
I can move it up and straight down and left and right and diagonally. I can close it and open it, and I can go forward and back.
That is just the most astounding thing I've ever seen. Can we shake hands?
Sure.
No, really.
Yeah.
Like, come right over here?
Yes, you come over
there.
Okay. Let me grasp your hand there. There we go.
Oh, my goodness. Wow.
And I can do a fist bump if you'd like.
That's amazing. What are you doing, Jan? What's going on in your mind as you're moving this arm around? What are you thinking?
Okay, the best way to explain it is, raise your arm.
Uh-huh.
Go. Now, right. What did you think about when you did that?
Well, not very much. I do it all the time.
Exactly. It's automatic.
Is that hard work? Are you having to concentrate?
It was hard work getting there. I struggled greatly to go up and down at the beginning. Now up and down is so easy, I don't even think about it. Side to side. Don't even think about it.
Just like
that.
Your arms used to.
Yes.
We asked Dr. Ling, the program manager, where all of this is headed.
I'm old enough to have watched Neil Armstrong take that step on the moon, and to watch Jan do that, I had the same tingles, because I realized that we have now stepped over a great threshold into what is possible, and very importantly, what patients can now expect in terms of restoration. This is a very important part, not rehab, but restoration of function.
I wonder what your experience with Jan has taught you about the brain and the brain's ability to adapt to new circumstances.
I think it's taught me something really fundamental, and that is we are tool users, and our arms and our legs are just tools for our brain. And so when we give another tool, in Jan's case, a robot arm, she will adapt to that tool to do the things that she wants to do.
Of course, many who could use a robot arm are not paralyzed like Jan. They're amputees. And for them, the project has found a way to connect the arm without brain surgery. 57-year-old Johnny Matheny lost his arm to cancer. Dr. Albert Chee from Johns Hopkins Hospital found the nerves that used to go to Johnny's hand and move them to healthy muscles in his remaining limb.
Now, elbow extension.
Sensors on his skin pick up the brain signals from the nerves and use those signals to control the robotic arm.
Come here, I want to see you.
So even though the limb is missing, the brain still sends the signals as if the limb was still there.
Correct.
Johnny, it feels in your mind like your hand is there again?
Yes.
As if your arm had never been lost?
Correct.
Unlike Jan, the connection for Johnny runs both ways. Sensors in the fingers send signals back so he can feel what he's touching.
Okay, I'm holding the object, and you can close on it.
To see how well, we put him to the test.
Hard or soft?
Soft.
Correct. Very good. Now let's try again. I'm holding the object. Hard or soft?
Soft.
Yep, quite right. All right.
He got it right every time.
Hard or soft?
Hard.
Amazing.
The next person to have Jan surgery will have additional sensors placed in the brain to receive the sensation of touch. Andy Schwartz believes that will help with some of the things that Jan has trouble with.
Okay.
For example, sometimes when she looks right at an object, she can't grab it.
Okay, I'm going to take the cone away. Just go ahead and close it.
Oh, sure.
So as soon as I take the cone away, there's no problem. But as soon as I put the cone there, she can't do it.
Why is still a mystery. The progress is coming rapidly. They're working on a wireless version of the implant to eliminate the connection in the skull. And Dr. Jeffrey Ling told us that the lab experiments will one day enter the real world.
We're going to not stop at just arms and hands. I think that it's going to open the way for things like sight and sound. And in my dream, I dream that we'll be able to take this into all sorts of patients, patients with stroke, patients with cerebral palsy, and the elderly.
I think when other quadriplegics see what I'm doing with the arm, they're all going to say, oh, wow, I wish I could do that.
That's the way I like to get cookies. Awesome. Thank you so much.
I just feel very honored to be the one who gets to do it.
Go to 60minutesovertime.com to see the bomb-diffusing robot known as Robo Sally in action.